can be seated.
I'm going to stand.
You know, if Satan is very good at what he does, the powers of darkness are very good at what they do. Because if everyone knew that there was more pleasure in the realms of the kingdom than there is in the realms of men, there wouldn't be anybody left in the realms of men anymore. The only people really be left there are people who are just stuck on, you know, power. They want to overthrow God. Just because there's people, you know, people that have their different, people have their different categories of sin and iniquity that they love. Some people's thing is power, domination over other men. Power within the framework of governmental power and financial power. So those people would still be probably trying to do what Satan did so long ago. We just call him Satan because he's the adversary. No one knows his name. In Isaiah, the prophet referred to him as the Shining One. He still comes as a Shining One. He still comes and transforms himself as a messenger of light, just a deceiver. Praise God for Jesus, because he's the light. Amen. I tell you, you got somebody trying to be a poser of light, and then the light shows up. Tell you the light. It's just a settled issue who the light is. Yes. There's more power and more authority that can be found in any other area of life. Just a little steparana, a couple of little syllables of God speaking through me. See, people don't know what the language of the Spirit is. It's where God himself speaks through us. When this event took place, and we read about it in Acts chapter 2, Scripture says, and they all begin to speak with other language, another language, a heavenly language, the language of the Spirit, as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance, as the Holy Ghost, in other words, spoke through them. Hallelujah. It's enough to break off every sickness and disease, right? Just a couple little sentences in the Kodos Paranea. And then we go ahead and we make it known also with the understanding. Men work from the known to the unknown, but we work from the unknown to the known. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because everything about the kingdom of God, everything about the Lord goes far beyond all that men have been imprisoned by in their culture. You're just a product of your culture. You can think you something special if you want. I'm telling you, listen to me. If you listen to me on my web or YouTube or in here right now, you're nothing more than a product of your culture and a product of your society and the place that you were lived. I'll take you out to the jungles of Indonesia and show you people who are a product of their culture. Take you out into the jungles of the Congo and show you people who have a different product. Huh? Take you up into Russia and show you people a different product. Take you to Nepal, show you people a different product. Northern Bangladesh, Sikkim, the northeast regions of India, different product. Kashmir, different product. You want a really wild one? Mountains of Tajikistan bordering the nation that has become a big highlight because of Osama. Not Pakistan, but I'm forgetting the name of it. It's a common one. Everybody knows that one. Yeah. Somebody said, There's a really different culture there. You're just a product of your culture. You think that you believe things based upon your own logical conclusions and supposed rational explanation that was given to you. That wasn't rational at all. Just somebody knew a bunch of words and you respected their title or whatever, and you know. And then the deceiver got in the big middle of it. And now you basically hook, line, and sinker, you know, taken away by the snare of the devil, the adversary, by a stinking lie. It's terrible to be hoodwinked, find out you in the midst of a lie, having been ripped off and deceived. It just leaves you feeling terrible. You know, it does, doesn't it?
Yes.
So many people are going to find out too late. God, who created everything and has proved it over and over again in every dimension. Every dimension, even in science already, it's proven. God's proven himself, even in science to this day. It is. People don't know about the anthropic theory. It was something that was espoused by guys from Yale and Princeton. It had nothing to do with wanting to justify creation. they put all of, and all of the statistics of life that we understand today in a statistical model, and the statistical model said it's created by design for man. Literally, I mean, go, you can find, this is not, I'm not making this up, this is public information. And it's like 1 in 10 million is the probability that it happened by chance. So somebody said, well, then what we're gonna have to do is we're gonna have to come up with a parallel universe theory. So we can have 10 million universes simultaneously existing so we could have this one event. Always trying, always diligently trying to explain away God, to put him away. You know what? Here's what I've discovered. If you try to talk to the minds of men, nothing will ever change. Because everybody knows in their heart what's really going on. Everybody knows at the moment of reality. It's called foxhole salvation. Yeah. There is no atheist or agnostic in the foxhole. There isn't. In the moments of crisis, God! Because you know deep inside, once you start peeling off all the layers of pretense and false tense and all their other tense, huh? You don't have somebody telling you about all the different religions and you're picking and choosing, I like this cherry flavor and this, you know, Hindu flavor and this, Buddhist flavor. I mean, it's so funny to me how people want to go to Hinduism. It really is. With 33 million gods, right? Come on now. How can you acknowledge 33 million gods? Come on. Some of you sitting here, you from India, you know. And then if you sin, you got 70, come on. Savitri, what you gonna do? You sin one time, you got 76,000 life cycles as a lower being to come back and do it again. Give me a break. You know, dear people, Father came in his great love and his mercy, made a way to break off all the yokes of sin and sickness and disease and darkness, and living in sadness and pain and sorrow and torment. So we come into this wonderful life with him. Abundant life.
Hallelujah.
Abundant life. It's called eternal life. It's life that is without end. It's a quality of life. That's a quantity of life. Sometimes we just think about the quantity. I'm telling you right now, if you don't have the quality, you don't want the quantity. But I'm going to tell you, at the same time, you're going to get the quantity whether you want it or not, whether you have the quality or not. Because God created us to live forever. It's just the way it is. Why? Because He didn't create us to go walking around in this sin, this iniquity, and darkness, to have a broken relationship. He created us to have an unending relationship. The worst thing I can think of is to lose my wife that I've been married to for 30 years. To have any kind of loss in relationship with her. Because every day it gets better. But the reality of it is that's what Father created. He created a relationship that's supposed to last forever, that's supposed to have no sorrow, supposed to have no death in it. Supposed to have no pain, no torment. People, I hear people all the time saying that they're making their own choices and they have the right to make their own choices. Well, that's fine, but reality of it is, that's all true, but you don't. Because if you were making your own choices, you would never choose to be unhappy, sorrowful, sad, tormented, in sickness, in pain, in disease. You would never choose to be poor, miserable, wretched. You never choose it. What you would choose is you would choose to be rich and well-liked and feel love all the time and have peace all the time and be blessed all the time and have joy all the time and have love all the time. Now listen, this is what Father's chose for us. He chose for us to have love all the time. And people go, oh really? I mean, you expected me really to have love all the time? Oh, is it just so difficult? He expects us to have joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, that's, what do you think, man? I mean, what are you thinking? You know, we all got to live in this world. That's an illusion, some pipe dream or whatever. No. No, see, he gave us a new spirit. See, I was born again. Yes. The former me that was born of my mother and my father doesn't even exist anymore. People might say, oh, I remember you when? Well, I don't know who you're talking about. What do you mean? You remember me when? When what? All I know is this life I now live in Christ Jesus, this life I have in Christ Jesus. Listen, you're not going to go into the kingdom of God unless you have the life of Christ Jesus, unless you live the life of Christ Jesus, unless Jesus lives in you. Do you have, really, the reality of it is do you have the life? the life of Christ Jesus. And reality of it is, if you don't have the life of Christ Jesus, you have the death of the powers of darkness. You're either a child of the living God or you're a child of the devil. And it's just, people think everybody's born in this world, we all children of God. Nonsense. It's not true. Does it reduce our love and our compassion, our respect and our appreciation for every human being? It's just not true. Because you were born in sin, and then from that moment on, you were shaped in iniquity. Every day of your life, you were taught how to be a rascal. How to have broken covenant, how to make the wrong decisions, how to think improperly, how to ultimately go from curse to curse rather than blessing to blessing. But Father in His love made an opportunity, and it's reproducible and it's provable as much as anything else is reproducible and provable, that we can be born in righteousness and then shaped in purity, shaped in His holiness. Woo. Born in righteousness and holiness, and every day shaped in purity, knowing it, shaped in the goodness and the glory of the living God. Wow. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I just pray in Jesus' name that you will grab a hold of what Father has for you today and not squander it and not neglect it. And not just leave it, as when I say squander, just leave it there on the shelf and pick it up every Sunday morning. Or maybe some people pick it up only on Easter and Christmas. I had a person say to me the other day, said, yeah, I know God. I go to church on Christmas and Easter. I said, well, that's not much knowledge. I said, you know about Him. And I was as gentle as I possibly could be. I didn't want to take what little bit He had away from Him. Okay, I don't want to take what little bit you have away from you either. I'm going to try very cautiously to make sure that you recognize any knowledge of Jesus Christ is a place, it's a beginning. It's like when the scribe, the lawyer that was trained among the Pharisees, came to Jesus and he began to describe to Jesus the things of what God wants for our life, to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all our mind, with all our strength, to love our neighbor as ourselves. Jesus says, you're not far from the kingdom. You know, there's this little bit of information, but you're not far from the kingdom. However, the invitation is, come on into the kingdom. And the only way you can get into the kingdom is if you'll let the Holy Ghost come upon you and change you and transform you. When that happens, first and foremost, you listen to me. You have to have a heart that's saying inside, I don't want this world anymore. I don't want sin anymore. I don't want iniquity anymore. I want to be delivered. I heard that there was a way to know the living God. I'm earnest about knowing the living God. And as we go through the processes of time now, as we are approaching that day of the coming of the Lord Jesus, men are going to a place further and further away from wanting to know anything about God. But we stand here in a place today where we're believing God for an awakening to come, where men will want to know about God, where suddenly they become an awareness. Wait a minute. I'm going to stand before the living God. Wait a minute. There's a better life for me to be living. Wait a minute. I don't have to live like this anymore. In that place, you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon you and transforms you and creates a whole new being in Jesus. It's not a whole new you. It's a whole new Him now living in you. And there's so many people who responded to salvation and they came and did just this religious thing and they said, I'm saved. You're saved. From what? I got changed. You did. From what to what? Because I look at people still living under the yoke of that which God has given us the authority and the ability to set people free from. And I'm just going to open up a couple of verses of Scripture. I'm just going to show you here just a couple of verses of Scripture here. And, you know, and I want to start here in Mark chapter 6. And there's this verse of Scripture here that I want to read to you. And I can't really see the page really well, so I'm going to go over here and do the old search thing quickly. tell you what, just go to Acts 26. Let's start there. Thank you, mighty God. Paul describes the authority and the ability that Father has given to us to help you. The authority that Father has given to us to go and deliver you. In Mark chapter 6, the Lord Jesus sent them out to go and preach the gospel of repentance, to deliver them from their sicknesses and from their diseases. They went out, they preached the gospel, and people got delivered from their sicknesses and from their diseases and from their torments. Because he also, in that context, gave them the authority over every unclean spirit to cast out every devil. Now I want you to understand, every sickness, every disease, every torment of the mind, every torment of the life comes from an unclean spirit. It certainly doesn't come from the Holy Spirit. It certainly just isn't a product that you're standing around over here and it's just all, something that you're choosing for yourself. And somebody said, well, it's just a natural consequence of living in this world. No, it's a natural consequence of living under the rule of the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. So there are many people who said that they know the Lord and they're still in bondage. Well, no, you may have at some moment in time responded to an altar call, but you didn't come to know him. And he wants you to come to know him. And I'm going to lay these things out for you here so that you can see them. There are people who say they know him and they don't know him. And then there are people who know him, but they're not willing to do what he's commanded to do in order to prepare for his coming. And then there are also another category of people who knew him or who walked with him and then turned again unto sin and iniquity. And we got to sort this thing out because people are living in various different degrees of deception in many respects. Two Sundays ago, a person was responding to the altar call, and I saw them coming towards me, and all I could see was their uncertainty. I said, you're not being real. There's a lot of uncertainty. I'm not looking for a head count here. I'm not going to have you come up here and say that you're now giving your life over to the Lord Jesus, and you're going to have the experience of salvation, and your heart's not ready for salvation. Because you still want to hold on to your life. You still want to do the things you've been doing. You still want to go to the bars. You want to still go and party. You want to still have it your own way. No, when you come to Jesus, you're coming to die with him at Calvary because you see your sin is exceedingly sinful. You don't want to live in that realm anymore. You want to escape. You were warned by the Spirit to flee from the wrath that is to come. That's what John said to the Pharisees when they came to his baptism and the Sadducees. He said, who warned you? How did you get warned? Because I see the hardness of your heart. Really, this is what he's saying. I see the hardness of your heart. I see the stubbornness of your thinking. So how did you ever get warned to flee from the wrath that is to come? And God, the Holy Ghost, wants to come with the warning. And Father, by the Spirit of the Lord, wants to minister through you and me to begin to break off the yokes, to break off the lies and the deception. And it is a great challenge in the United States of America. It's so much easier overseas when we begin to talk to people who worship devils on a daily basis and who have to try to continually make sacrifice for these devils so that the devil doesn't come and kill their kids or come and destroy their crops. Suddenly I'm saying, I got a way for you to escape the devil. They're coming running. Because that's the world that they live in. The world that we live in is the greatest of illusions. The culture that we live in that allows you supposedly to be the one who navigates your own life and makes your own choices and be the ruler of your own self empowers you to do these things. Gives you all of these permission slips. and solutions to your problems, like lawyers and doctors and insurance plans. If your house burns down, no problem. Go ahead and torch it yourself so you can get collect the money. I mean, it's just all these. We live in a false world. We live in a world that is just make-believe. It doesn't ever really cause us to deal with the reality of the disaster that is before us. It's just the truth.
Just the truth.
Paul said that the Lord gave him the ability, and this is the ability of all mankind, verse 18, chapter 26. He says to open up their eyes. But when the Lord Jesus came, spiritualize, to open up their eyes, open up their spiritual eyes. Today, there is an anointing here. God has given us the anointing to open up your spiritual eyes so that you don't have to be blinded anymore to the reality of the fact that you're going to stand before the living God and give an account for the deeds of that were done in your body. The living reality that there is a means by which now you can escape all the stuff that you're in, all the bondage that you're in, all the death and sickness and disease and demonic harassment that you're in. Because if our gospel be hid, that's the good news. The good news is you don't have to live in sickness, disease, pain, torment, under the demonic realm, to live in hell now and to be cast in the lake of fire later. Because the Lord is always setting before us life and death, blessings and curses. And he says in Deuteronomy chapter 30, choose life and live. There's set before us every day heaven and hell. He would say, I can't believe that God would send anybody to hell. You send yourself to hell. You make a choice. You're living in hell right now because you chose to live in hell by refusing heaven. Suddenly somebody's eyes gets open and they go, wait a minute. I'm living in hell. I'm under the harassment of demon spirits. And God's made a way for me to escape. I don't have to live in this torment. I don't have to live in this disaster anymore. I don't have to live with the desire for iniquity. I don't have to live with the desire to hurt other people through thievery, robbing them, stealing from them, lying to them, cheating on them, breaking covenant with them, loving them one day, hating them the next. And the list goes on. The strife and all the rest. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me. And here's what he's anointed not only Christ Jesus to do, but every one of us to do who have been born of him. Called to do the same works that he does, empowered and anointed to minister the same gospel. He's anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. Who are the poor? Those are the people who are needy. Suddenly, I'm in need. I need something more. There's got to be more to life than this. People get on a sad go-around. Not a merry-go-round, but a sad go-around. Believing that one day that they're going to have everything that they want as they pursue it, to try to achieve it in this life. And if once you get there, you discover that no, you're no different. In fact, you're worse off than you were before you ever even started. Unfortunately, most people spend their whole life on the sad go-around. They just always believe that if they can get it, it's the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. You never grew up. And if you get it, if you could just get there to the end of the rainbow, then all of a sudden you're going to have everything that you want. And unfortunately, you die going around and around and around in the sad go around. Thinking that somehow something that you do is going to bring you credit. Somehow it's going to bring you approval. Somehow you're going to have more acceptance. Somehow people are going to respect you more. Somehow you're going to have, it's nonsense. You have all of that. You have all that and have nothing. Still you have nothing. So the Lord anointed us to preach the gospel to the poor. To bind up those who are broken in heart. Because I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't know Jesus, you messed up. And don't try to pretend. Because most people that are honest will recognize I'm messed up. I'm broken up. I've had one problem after another. It's not my fault. Everybody else did it to me. Yeah, and you're doing it to everybody else too. But we won't talk about that right now. I do know that everybody else did that to you because that's all the world can do. Because it's under the terror and the reign of a taskmaster called Satan, the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world. There's proofs coming and going, right, left, and center of the fact that Satan exists, that evil exists, and a demonic realm is having its way among men. There's proof everywhere you turn. There's even more proof, hallelujah, that God is who he says he is, and that He's a good God, and He is, and that He is, that He is the one who is life forevermore, and that all He has for us is every good thing. That's all people want. If man was created to live in the good thing, he was created to live in the pleasures forevermore. He was created to live in this abundant life, and he tries to find it. He truly pursues it through all the various different tricks and avenues that the world around them and the culture around them would impose upon them, saying it's right here. If you can just attain this, you can have it. But it ain't there. It's all a lie. But that's what Satan does. He lies. Christ Jesus has come to deliver us from the lie, so that we may know the truth, and by the truth be liberated. Hallelujah. Then so this is the spirit of truth. Hallelujah. This is the good news. This is the gospel, so that we can understand where the lie is. Say, I'm not getting tricked again. You got me once, twice, three times, 1,000 times. Huh? Just so gullible. Well, God, the Holy Ghost comes and shines the floodlight of heaven upon things, and now all of a sudden we're able to see what's truth and what's lie. He gave us the power to liberate people. The anointing is for the purpose of liberating people from their prison, the prison of sickness and disease and torment, to deliver them, to let the oppressed go free so that demon spirits can no longer harass them and torment them and rule them. That's why the Lord Jesus, the gospel is all about giving power to cast out unclean spirits, authority over all the works of Satan, to be able to liberate people. Is to go and preach the gospel of repentance, which means I want to be totally different. I want to change. I don't want to walk according to the course of this world. I want to know the living God. I want to walk with Him. Amen. I don't want to live in hell anymore. I'd rather live in heaven. Everybody makes their choices every day. You want hell or heaven? People participate on a daily basis with demonic spirits that are part of hell. They come under their influence and they become servants to them by doing their wicked deeds through their own bodies. As they abuse themselves and as they abuse men and as they sin against God and sin against life, as they profane that which is so sacred and so glorious. Oh, dear people, we pray that your eyes get opened up and you'll keep them opened up in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray that you, every person in this place, will be just so earnest, you're shaking and trembling on the inside to know God more, to walk with Him perfectly in every way. Yeah. Somebody said, are you perfect? No, but I want to be. Hallelujah for Him. And Father has given me the authority too, because He said, be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Someone had told you that sin is okay, that God understands. Right now, listen, they lied to you and they deceived you. And if you come under that yoke, you're going to end up in hell with them, because God, sin is not okay and God does not understand. Father comes to the worst conditions ever in humanity. Like the worst conditions, the worst people. The people who have blown it the worst and lived in such deep darkness, dark, dark iniquity. And He says, I forgive you. Go and sin no more. That's God's mercy coming to the worst situations, but saying to the worst situations, now, go and sin no more. He gives us power to do it. It's not an unrealistic expectation. It's being released from the strongholds of Satan and liberated now to fly. Amen. I'm no longer in the cage. I'm liberated. Now I can fly in the free air of the living God. Hallelujah. And live in the beauty and the splendor of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I'm not bound to a cage being thrown crumbs anymore. Taught how to chirp like a parrot. I like sin. I like sin. I like sin. Polly wants a carrot. Parrot. A cracker or a carrot, whatever. I like sin. All that nonsense. Hallelujah. The authority that we've been given to turn people from darkness to light. People, I'm going to just tell you, this is who we are. This isn't just something. This is the heavenly vision. This is the definition of it. This is who we're supposed to be. It's not just a spiel in which we try now to go and, you know, count numbers and count heads. Give me a break. It's about an authority that we begin to live in, to where that our lives impact everybody around us, both spoken and unspoken. Hallelujah. Where people, where the authority of God is there to lay hands upon the sick, to deliver them, to see somebody under a yoke of demon power and command it to go out. I've been in situations over and again. One situation stands out to me. I was in the Barrio Logan one time, and there was rumblings going on between the Red Steps and the Trentes, and that's before they, supposedly somebody said there's some kind of settling out, they're making dope deals together or something now, whatever, so they got big peace treaty going on. But it was the rumbling days, and I had a guy, he came up to me, he was awe. He was just totally awe, cracked out. You could tell that he was really out of his mind high. And he starts coming and doing the stuff that they do just before they pop you upside the head, you know. And asking me why, you know, why was I in his turf? What was I doing there? What was this white boy doing, you know, in the Hispanic square, basically? I just stood there under the anointing. Man, he melted like wax in the sun. He melted. Before the encounter was over, he was weeping. Hallelujah. I didn't have to get in a stance and, you know, do the old kung fu, you know, whatever. Man, trusting in their own human ability. You know, I see these preachers running around. You know, I love all you guys, but see you running around with gun permits. Guns attract guns. That's not very wise to do. I know I'm very good with guns. My dad got me my first gun when I was a very young boy. When you take a gun, that means you're ready to blow somebody's head off. You don't just play around with guns. People are trusting in their own self. This nonsense. What are you going to do with that gun? What are you going to do with that gun? By the way, what are you going to do with that gun? Because it's not for show. Because the people that you should be concerned about, they see that gun, they're going to fire first. Unless you're ready to fire first. Yeah. Are you ready to fire first? You know, it just, we got all these crazy ideas and notions about how we're going to protect ourselves and how we're going to take care of ourselves and how we're going to manage our own lives, even in sometimes in the greatest context of people who believe in the Holy Ghost. But when it comes right down to it, they still have areas that they live under fear, and thus they have no power to deliver anybody else from the fear of it. Somebody tell me about churches that actually have snipers up on their roofs. Yeah, they got snipers for Sunday. Because of all the shootings. My goodness gracious. Give up on it, man. Why don't you just all get shot and go to heaven? I mean, why don't you live, you'll be a more witness of God just doing that. Then give me a break. What is it that you believe in? There's no authority to execute these things that God has given us the power and the privilege to execute. Because we live as servants to the wrong side. We live under that. We're dominated by the same spirit we're supposed to be setting people free from. Whether it's in the areas of lust of the flesh or lust of the eye or the pride of life or some intimidation and domination of fear and propaganda and disinformation. Which all these preachers that we're talking about, you know, how this, you know, the military and Obama was going to do something bad through the military exercises that they had, you know, that ended back in October. Why don't they fess up now that they were products of deception and all the stuff they were saying was a lie? No, this let drift away. Nonsense. You need to be responsible for the lies they bought into and then the lies they propagate. Because the reality of it is they just pick up the next disinformation. And that's going on in the United States of America. That propaganda is going on in America like never before. And Satan is the master of disinformation. Always trying to create something that doesn't even exist to get people all in an uproar. And he uses those people that are supposed to be, you know, the defenders of that which is right and good. Just that's the way Satan does it. Why must we be such gullible people? When God has given us the light of truth in his word, given us the light of life in Christ Jesus, has given us the spirit of truth, the Holy Ghost who's come to lead us and guide us, and we buy into lies all the time. Well, that's what I feel. Well, why don't you rise up against what you feel and call what you feel for what it is against God, because it don't line up with the truth. Oh, but well, you want me to say something that's not really true because I feel pain in my body. No, I want you to say something that is really, really true, something that is bigger than what you think and what you feel and what you know, and that's what God declared. He's given you power over unclean spirits, so he wants you to go preach the gospel, cast out devils, and heal the sick and those that are diseased. That's what he does. He's come to liberate from every power of Satan. He's come to liberate from every power of lust and demonic torment that goes on in people's spirit. And life, and yet the church, so many of them are imprisoned by it. He says, heavenly vision, this is who we are, this is what we do. We turn people from the power of Satan unto God. Why? so that they may receive forgiveness of sins, so that they may have their sins eliminated, erased, expunged, done away with, lifted off of them and removed. That's the way that you can translate that particular Greek word for forgiveness. Ophesis. Maybe translated it in all those things that I just said. And bring them into an inheritance in which all of the saints, all of the holy ones who are sanctified or set apart unto God now enjoy through the faith that is in Christ Jesus, or the faith that is in Him as it's written here. And then before I get into what I really feel that I want to just lay down on you in a real strong way here in a minute, it's just making sure everybody knows what side they're on, what they're supposed to be doing with their lives, what we were empowered by God to do in the first place. I'm going to tell you right now, listen, God's not going to count how much money you gave in the offering. He's not going to count how many souls you won. He's not going to count all the things, how many church services or meetings you attended. He's not going to count them. He's going to count how your, what your relationship with Him is, and your relationship and the intimacy that you have with Him, the oneness you have with Him, is then going to produce out of that this outworking of divine power and authority, because the gospel finds its definition within the framework of the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because He's anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor, to set people free, but recognizing, wait a minute, I got to be set free before I can ever set anybody free. And whatever I've come under the authority of, whatever I'm in bondage to, if I'm under the grip of fear, if I'm under the grip of some kind of addiction and sin, I'm going to also then be in that place in prison, in the same prison that the lost and the dying world are. I am going to be limited and under the same power and restraint that all the world that does not know Jesus lies under. So who am I going to be able to affect? Who am I going to be able to set free? Then we'll just look with me in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 9. And we hear this. You don't need a listen. You don't need a commentary on her. Commentator on this. It just is what it says. I love to watch all these various different theologians squirm over 2 Peter chapter 2 verse 20. It is amazing to me because so many scriptures literally get up in the face of modern theology and says, you're wrong. And now what are you going to do when the scripture is saying everything you believe is wrong? Now you're going to have to try to completely explain it away with what you believe. And boy, is that ever a bunch of babblings. Is that ever a bunch of illogical nonsense? Throwing the Greek around, throwing Latin around, throwing some ancient language around like Ugarit or Akkadian that no one else knows to try to prove your point. No, do all that. It still says exactly what it says that you haven't dealt with yet. He's like, it's... sleight of hand, smoke and mirrors, you know. Are you with me?
Yes.
Come on, I'm just trying to get you to talk to you a little bit. Talk to yourself a little bit. So that you can begin to open up your heart and begin to let the Holy Ghost talk to you. Because He'll begin to speak to your spirit liberating things that will cause you to go, how could have I been so stupid all these years? How could have I been so blinded? But we can stop up our ears to His voice. He comes to appear to us. He comes to show us. He comes to reveal the truth to us. He comes to cause us to know that we must flee from the wrath to come. He comes to cause us to understand that His judgment is against sin and iniquity. He comes to cause us to understand the glorious life that He has for us to live. But we can stop up our ears to Him. We don't have to listen. So many people who've responded to the hype that many people give in the context of church and preaching. They didn't respond to the cross of Calvary. They didn't come to lose their life, to now be born again, to come into a whole new life. They just responded to the numbers thing. And now, within 2, 3, 4 months, they fall away and said, I tried Christianity. There's so many statistics of people tried Christianity and it didn't work for them. Or they just tried a religion. They never were born again. They never had an encounter with God. They didn't have anybody who was just dedicated to one product, a transformed life, not just numbers on a board. You know, we were raised in this. We were raised, you look up on the front, and one of the first things you see is the clock, big clock. And it wasn't pointing, you know. Big clock back this way. Big clock pointing for the pastor to have to look at, so he has to obey the time. Big clock. Okay, this way, over here is the numbers thing. Total numbers of offering last week. Total number of offering for the entire month. Total number of offering year to date. Total number of visitors last week. Total number of souls saved last week. Total number of souls saved for the month. Year to date, souls saved. It's just a numbers game, coming and going. There's one set of numbers for me, and then there's another set of numbers for them. And it steers our heart away from the reality of what we're supposed to be doing here. And the intimacy of walking with the Lord and knowing God and interacting with Him. And then out of that interaction and out of that relationship, having this fire of God in our belly. Hallelujah. A fire of God on the inside of you, a fire of God in your belly is going to be causing you to be a very different kind of a person. You're not going to be doing stuff because you have to. You're going to be doing things in God because you want to. I got more power than any witch doctor on the planet. I got more. You take all the medicine men, all the shaman, all the witch doctors, put them in the meeting, man, I'm going to have a Holy Ghost time. And I've had number of opportunities for that, and I want many more. Because, I mean, goodness gracious, the smallest little person in the kingdom of God, 3-4 year old, that knows how to just raise their hand and worship God, has more power than any demonic realm that exists on the planet. And yet people abdicate to the smallest little sin. They abdicate to the smallest little enticement. It's amazing to me. When you have power and authority over all the works of Satan, you have power and authority, you've been given enough strength to be have the omnipotence of God. I know I shock people when I say that. But Paul said in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. So then I say to the theologian, I say to the biblical linguist, go figure that out. And they go, oh, that's right. That's His speaking of His power. Yeah, so hallelujah. That's all power. Hallelujah. For what? So that we may effectively deal with the spiritual wickedness. So that we can first and foremost recognize who we are and not allow it in our life, and then begin to function in that same ministry of the Lord Jesus, who didn't allow it in His life either, who had authority, who then gave authority to His disciples. And praise God, you know, here we get to see another model, because now with them, we get to see people who are not matured in the things of the Spirit, who fail, who fall short, and even who sin. But yet there is a mercy and there is a forgiveness that restores them to the same authority. But you don't see Peter continuing to deny Jesus. He did it one time, and then we're over that now. Hallelujah. Now if we would have had, oh, here he is, denying Jesus again. Come on, people. We make things that don't exist to be the model of what we're going to do. And the things that do exist, we throw aside and say it's not relevant. My God, help us. And praise God. Praise God, He is helping us. Yes. And praise God, He is my God. Amen. Hallelujah. And He wants to be your God too.
Yes.
Amen. 1 John chapter 3, in verse 8, we read this. He that commits sin is of the devil. That's pretty good. So somebody comes along and says, well, come on, you know, be careful, because we don't want to discourage people. He that practices sin. Okay, fine. He that practices sin is of the devil. Fine. So quit practicing right now. Amen. Hallelujah. Huh? Because there's one thing about being tripped up and falling into some snare of the enemy, and it's another thing about continually doing it. Huh? You're good for 1 month, and then it comes right back. And then you're good for 1 month, and it comes right back. I'm dead right now, people. You need deliverance. You've not been delivered from that thing. You hear me? It has authority over you, and it has no right to have authority over you, and there are no excuses that count, because God has given us all authority to set everybody else free, which got to begin with us.
Yeah.
Hello. I have power to set everybody else free, but I'm not free. I have power against all unclean spirits, and every realm of sin and iniquity comes out of the realm of unclean spirits, and yet I'm under the authority of unclean spirits. Hold up. Time out. Let's start where we need to start and then move forward from there. Amen. In Jesus' name. He says, he that is sins, commits sins or practice sin. How reoccurring sin. How do we want to say it? Somebody said, you mean you don't sin? Hey, listen, I didn't say that. I said, I do not want to ever sin. And I'm going to tell you right now, when God shines anything on the floodlight on my life where I've allowed my mouth to speak something wrong against another person, I don't just act like, you know, everybody else does it. I come on a Holy Ghost conviction, and I repent, and I say, Father, forgive me for speaking bad of someone. Because I know it's just as much sin as any other sin. Huh? Praise God. We're not in here over here committing adultery. Hello. We're not over here committing fornication. We're not over here in uncleanness and lasciviousness. We're not over here in witchcraft and variance and strife and emulation. And if we do get in variance will trip you up easily. Strife will trip you up easily. Huh? Praise God that we can be taught of God and learn how to keep our mouth shut. Amen. Hallelujah. Learn how to pray in the Holy Ghost so something lovely comes out of our lips. Hallelujah. And learn how to just give it to God instead of trying to defend ourselves, trying to build ourselves up by putting somebody else down. Huh? Trying to defend ourselves by attacking someone. Huh? Give me a break. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Praise God for his goodness. Well, we want to do this. We want to give ourselves to these things that we might have a function of God's full dynamite authority, explosive authority in and through our lives. I'm telling you right now, you're in a good place. You're being taught of God here. I'm telling you, I know I'm a phenomenon. I teach the word. I just do nothing but teach people the word, preach the word. Somebody said you teach the word and then, you know, you preach excitement. I preach the word. I teach the word. I prophesy the word. I'm a phenomenon because there's very few people like me on the planet. You can go wherever. You can go all over the place and learn how to be preacher preaching, and you can learn how to do this, and you can learn how to do that. People, you want to learn how to function in the Word of God and speak the Word of God and speak the Word of God only, because if we're found cultivating those things which Father's cultivating, when he comes to us as the early and the latter rain, we're going to be found right in the center of the explosive outpourings of heaven. And that's exactly where you want to be. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. You can chase a dream if you want. Huh? Just make sure it's a dream that is given to you by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Make sure it's a Holy Ghost dream and it lines up with the Word of God in every dimension and every way. Praise the name of the Lord. Don't cheat. He that commits sins of the devil sins from the beginning. And that's what Jesus is saying, the Lord just saying, it just exists in his realm. It don't exist outside of his realm. You got to get in his realm to do it. Ain't no sin in heaven. Huh? The Holy Ghost has come to lead us and guide us into all truth that we're supposed to be living in and walking in. He ain't teaching us that. And in his presence, it doesn't exist there. In his presence is fullness of joy, but a little bit of sin. Because every once in a while, it's so good, the Lord samples it out. Every so often. No, it's a satanic realm. That's all it is. It's a satanic realm. And see, if I can begin, as a preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, I can begin to break down the strongholds that the liars and the deceivers have taught, then I can help people to understand the difference between good and evil and recognize that because if people begin to recognize sin, the wrath of God abides upon it, it is a demonic realm, then I've now empowered you with a greater fortification and will to say, no, that isn't a choice that I'm going to make. No, that isn't something that is just, it's just common or ordinary. It's not going to be casual anymore. It's going to be a violent act of treason. People laugh at me when I say sin is treason. They laugh. Oh, Mark, the hammer, he's the guy who believes that sin is treason. I have more people didn't want me coming to their church because of the way that I preach about sin. It's not anything else, just because of it. Don't preach about sin, okay? Just preach about the gifts of the Spirit and the flow of the anointing. You're not going to have no real gifts of the Spirit. Satan will deceive you. He'll deceive you. He'll take it sideways. He'll take it sideways. Because he can come as an angel of light. I'm going to labor to get you saved. See, I haven't even really gotten to the point here that people need to really hear. I'm building up to it. Because I'm going to show you right. I'm going to get ready to show you here in just a few minutes. That just as 10 virgins went out to meet the Lord, went out to meet the bridegroom, 5 of them knew his will, but they weren't prepared. And he said, depart from me, I do not know you. They responded when it was too late. And there's a lot of people in the church right now. He says, that's what the kingdom is like. He said, then this is what the kingdom is going to be like. Here it is. I'm going to talk to you about that here in just a minute. I want to lay this foundation. I want you to understand. Huh? We used to have a time in our history of America that if it doesn't matter who you were, if you were a Baptist or Methodist or Pentecostal or Assembly of God, whatever you were, people were preaching the Bible. They were preaching the Word. It isn't that way anymore, really. It's people preaching all these various different preacher sermons. They compromise sermons that attract men, that make men feel comfortable and welcomed. You don't want that. The Lord says to us, He says, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested. And I want you to understand that God wants to reveal His Son through you and me. He's purposed to reveal His Son through you and me. The witness of salvation is that His Son is in being, that Christ Jesus is living out His life through you and me. The gospel is the revelation of Christ Jesus, the Son, in you and me. And for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested. We want Christ Jesus to be manifested. We want the Son of God to be manifested. We love the manifest presence, but He's manifested to destroy the works of sin. Because they're synonymous, they're equal. In this verse of Scripture, they're made equal. They're made equal, eh? They made equal. They're made equal, not only in this verse of Scripture, but in many verses of Scripture. I want you to be taught of God and not of men. And you know what? A big part of being taught of God is hearing somebody who's anointed of the Holy Ghost that had declared to you what God wrote in His Word, not something additional, what He wrote in His Word. When we get everything down that He written in His Word, then maybe we're ready for some additional. But right now, we're not ready. Hello. There's plenty to get down right here. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to look at 2 Peter 2:20 quickly. Maybe not so quickly. We say that usually just to try to get people to stay with us for just a few more minutes. Everybody's just so busy. I can't get it out fast enough to say it before people start walking out. The bleed. Well, I've had enough. I can't take any more. I've got other assignments. I've got other business to take care of. You're going to miss heaven. You're going to miss the sound of the trumpet. You've not placed those things that belong to the kingdom of God above everything else in your life, and you're going to miss it. This is what Jesus Christ says. You will miss it. You will be delivered and unto the portion of the transgressor. You will be given over to their portion and to their inheritance. I'm going to prove this to you real quickly here this morning. Before I go to that other state, I want to just continue this for a minute. Just want to talk about the worst state. This is the worst state. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20. Look at the worst state that men could be in. For if after they have escaped the pollution of the world, the corruption of the world. And remember, this is how Peter actually opened up 2 Peter. He said, we've been made partakers of the divine nature, and we have escaped the corruption or the pollution that is in the world through lust. We now have everything that pertains to life and godliness. Now, here's a people that had the divine nature. Here's a people who were born of the Spirit. Here's a people that had escaped the pollution and the corruption of the world, the power and the authority of the God of this world, the Spirit that now works in children disobedience. They had escaped. How did they escape? Through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For them then to again become entangled with that, to be overcome with that, to be entangled and overcome with the pollution, entangled and overcome with the corruption, entangled and overcome with its lust, entangled and overcome with its sin, entangled and overcome with its iniquity, with its the pleasures that are for a season. The latter end is worse for them than the beginning. This is the worst state. They were better off in their sin before they knew Jesus. You know, I want you to look with me quickly in a verse of Scripture in Luke chapter 12. and it stands out. And I, you know, if I could, the Lord would give me liberty. I could preach the rest of my life every day on Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7 and Luke chapter 12, because there's so much to say, and if people would start obeying God and living in that. Just listen, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15, be holy in all conversation, because God says, be holy even as I am holy. You start obeying God like that and everybody's going to say you're religious. That's the world we live in. That's the world we live in. Be holy in all your conversation. Be holy just as I'm. Oh, you're religious. Uh-huh. Yeah, you deceived. You under the prince of the power of the air. Now there is absolutely no way for you ever to find a clear dividing line between good and evil, between light and darkness, between God and Satan. There's no way to deliver you from the power of Satan because you believe you're in God. And when you are in Satan and believe you're in God, if that light that is in you be darkness, oh, how great is that darkness, that deception now holds you in a prison that is inescapable. And usually it is the result of having done exactly what Peter describes here in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20, to have known the Lord and then be entangled. Because it's entangled. It's not just a selling out on Jesus. It's not just a denying Jesus. It's becoming entangled with sin. It's becoming compromised. And then overcome. I'm going to tell you, those who are overcome are not making heaven. The only people who are making heaven are those who overcome. The biggest definition of one who's born of God is not their signs and wonders and miracles. It's that they overcome sin. They overcome the world, the prince and the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. They overcome every dimension of iniquity that has come to claim your soul, to hunt you with its power. And as soon as you begin to recognize this, all of a sudden sin isn't ordinary, it's not common, it's not another option. Man, when you just resolve yourself to live out, to do only the will of the Father, it doesn't matter where you're at, you're just living to do the will of the Father, all of a sudden in that consecration, you don't have a choice anymore. Because you now say, I will not do my own will, because I can't do my will and do the will of the Father. I have consecrated myself in the consecration that He has wrought for me, worked for me, to do only the will of the Father. And now that I am there, I find myself in good ground, because Jesus said, in Matthew 7, chapter 7, He said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is coming in. He says, those who do the will of the Father. The will of the Father is ultimately seen in Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 4, is those who no longer sin. Go read it. Amen. Doing the will of the Father. They don't live their life for themselves anymore. They do the will of the Father. They cease from sin. This is one of the few places on planet Earth right now that you can even hear anybody say this. On planet Earth. And as far as I'm concerned, this is the greatest testimony of revival that exists. For His Word. Because His words, that when God talks about revival, He's talking about His Word no longer being somehow fallen in the streets, somehow perishing, somehow not being heard. He's talking about His Word now being revived and being declared and being propagated. They perish for lack of knowledge of the Word. Revive us again according to Your Word. Hallelujah. People make revival all these different things. Revivals and great awakenings didn't come by all these other things. It came by strong preaching of the Word. It's true. I was had the privilege of preaching in one of the first churches built in America 243 years ago. And the documentation there of all the different revivalists that were there, from Jonathan Edwards to George Whitfield, and the sermons that they preached. If you were just a kind of a middle-of-the-road, not a fiery preacher, you were preaching way above any of the Holy Ghost Pentecostal preachers that are right now highlighted in the mainstream today. Because they have reduced the message because of their embarrassment, because of whatever, because of their need to be accepted, because of whatever. They've reduced the message and redefined the message so that people can bear to hear it in their thinking. They conformed to what Satan has demanded with respect to how people respond. Thus, you have huge churches You're not going to, you're hard pressed to hear a verse of scripture. It's a motivational thing. It's how you can be better and live better and live happier, and Jesus, he's the author of it. It doesn't matter to me how many times you throw Jesus out there. I want to hear a call to righteousness and holiness. I want to hear a call to a new life and a call to a new identity, to living out the will of the Father, to being those people who are the salt of the earth and the light unto the world. It's a totally different kind of lifestyle, a totally different kind of way of living. It's the lifestyle of Christ Jesus. It's the way of living of the kingdom of God. In Luke chapter 12, look at this verse of scripture with me. I believe it's verse 46. It's verse 47. And remember, this is in the context of seeking first the kingdom of God. Hey, this is in the context of don't be concerned about what you should wear, what you should eat. This is in context of putting everything that Father has above all other things and watching continually for your Lord, because you do not know what watch he's coming in. Being always prepared, because when we read about the 10 virgins, they were virtuous. They were going out to meet the bridegroom. They were all a part of the church. They all became drowsy while they were waiting for the Lord because he delayed his coming. They all fell asleep. They all woke up. Some knew the will of the Father and prepared. Others knew the will of the Father and did not prepare. And looky here. That's what verse 47 is about. He says, and the servant which knew his Lord's will and did not prepare, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten. And reality of it is, the Lord is using an allegory. She'll suffer the punishment. And then if you want to look at what the punishment is, you did just turn over here to Matthew chapter 25, and let me show you this real quickly, and then by the help of the grace of God, I'll just summarize this for you, and hopefully you walk out of here committed, consecrated, sober, and vigilant. And then start using excuses. Well, I got this and I got that. What does Father want for your life? Papa sets people down and begins to execute his will and describe to them what he wants for their life, and then people all the time getting all excited about what they want to go do, and they write God into it. Hold up. Slow down. Slow down a little bit. Because I've watched people run headlong into all kinds of problems, and then they say, oh God, why am I going through all this? And if they could hear the Lord answer, he would say, because you decided to. You made the choice. You didn't ask me. You just did what you wanted to do. And I watch this go down all of the time. I watch this happen right, left, and center. I've been doing this. I've been pastoring for a long time. And before I started pastoring, I was raised in the church. I mean, I watched this stuff go down all the time. Your people get settled in the will of the Father. Get settled in and seeking him. I don't care if you're on the moon. You can seek God just as well. You don't have assembly there, but you know what I'm saying. You can get developed in the things of the Spirit and do what God wants you to do and be sober and be vigilant and learn how to walk out all these things that Father has made available to us. Yes. He says, I set before you blessings and cursings. I set you before you death and life. I set before you. This day, really, he's saying heaven and hell. And he's saying choose heaven. He just simply says, obey me, and you'll have days of heaven upon the earth. Hello. Matthew chapter 25. Look at this. There are just some people who they're serious, bless their heart, they love Jesus so much, oh, they're just such good people, oh, they're just so serious, but they don't get it till it's too late.
Right.
There's always something missing. You could see, there's a lack of consecration, you could see there's something missing there. And if there's anything that the 10 virgins, it's the 5 that are wise and the 5 that are morons. that is what the word, the Greek word is. It's moria. And from that comes the Arabic word moron, okay, which all means fool. Five foolish, five morons. Now, we hate that. Just say fool because I'm offended by a moron. Well, help you. And the reason it hurts so bad is because you might be one, right? Would you rather be a moron or a fool? Well, they're equal. They're the same exact thing. There are five fools, five foolish. What are the foolish? They know the will of the Father. They know the will. They know what He wants. They just don't prepare themselves. They're not giving diligence to it. Right. There's five that are wise. They're prudent. They know what Father's will is. They know what to expect. They know what He said. He said, bring extra oil. They didn't prepare. They thought, well, you know, we got enough. I'm sure we got enough to get by. I do that with gas all the time. Yeah. Fuel in the car tank. My wife told me the other day, she's like, pull over, honey. We need to get gas. I'm on the phone. Oh, I'll be fine. I get down the road a little ways and I go, why didn't I listen to you? Because now suddenly I come to recognize she was right. When it's too far to turn back and make it. Now what I'm doing is interceding for a creative miracle. I'm making us both suffer. I turn off the air conditioning to save fuel. Praise God. He always is so faithful to me and makes up for my lack of prudence in listening to my wife. But there is a place where there is no making up the lack. There is a place that Father says, now you got to be responsible. I haven't come to that place with fuel yet. He hasn't said, no, I'm not listening to you. Over and again, we've kind of talked about this. He's still just like, because he knows I'm on a run. He knows patience. Who has time for patience? He realizes that I am running wide open and that to stop, the process of thinking is, if I stop at this fuel station, it's going to take me 10 minutes and I don't have that to spare. However, I don't think about at the moment of time, if I run out of fuel, you got it. Afterwards, came the virgin saying, Lord, they had to go by. They said to the five, give us. There's a time where you don't give when you're asked. There's a time it says, no, this is the hour. What I have is for the Lord. It belongs to Him. Go to those who sell and buy. So they take off. Look at their diligence. When they're earnest, they want to get this right. They ought to be given a pass. They ought to be given a permission slip. Look at all that they've gone through. Look at all their sacrifices. Look at all the obedience in their life. Argue from your humanistic point of view. Argue from your logic and your rational human thinking. But if you'll let God train you in the Word, all of a sudden you'll think about the severity, knowing the severity, the strictness of God, that He is not going to compromise His Word. And praise God He's not. Amen. Because He's already got it all figured out. And He knows with what the wrong heart and the wrong spirit will produce in people. And so He comes, so they come. Afterwards, the virgins come, say, don't get it till it's too late. We need oil. Give us some of yours. You got to get your own. You can't have mine. You got to go get your own. And if there's any message that people need to hear in their relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, it's that. You have to go to the source. You just can't live off of somebody else's anointing. Can't live off someone else's relationship with the Lord. Here's people, ministries have fallen. Ministries have done all kinds of things wrong. It didn't bother me. It didn't slow me down. I felt ashamed that the church, that the cross was embarrassed instead of embraced. But my relationship with the Lord wasn't wrapped up in them. I love them. Love them today. In many ways, Jimmy Swaggart's probably got the best program on television. At least he's preaching the Word. You hear me? I don't have no problem listening to him. He's got probably more money and more finances than any ministry today. Got more property, more ministry going down in more nations on the face of the earth. I think he has like something 80 different radio broadcasts in the United States of America alone. No problem. I'm sorry he embarrassed the cross. I pray that he's really made it right. You know, you're listening to me. I don't know. I'm not his judge. I can't judge that in the sense of where he's at right now. Because everything that I can see is right. And that's I leave it there. I leave it to the one who knows all men's hearts. However, if somebody's doing things wrong, then I can judge. But I don't judge after my own preferences or understanding or hearsay or what happened in the past. I judge according to the deed and say, wait a minute, that deed is wrong or that deed is right. And that is judgment. That judgment is defined me by the Word of God. And when I declare those things to you and you don't listen and you become stubborn and you don't repent, you're on your way to hell, man. I don't care how much you do good. I don't care how wonderful you are, how much money you gave in the offering basket, how many souls you saved. When you got things going on in your life that are wrong and God has spoken it to you and he's delivered it to you and you had some spirit of offense or some kind of prejudice going on in your thought life and your thinking and you refused the Word of God, you refused your opportunity to get right with God. And the more you refuse, the harder your heart becomes and the more resistant you become to the Spirit of the Lord. And this is reality. And it's a tragic thing to recognize and to know this, that many of the people, there's a population of the people that sit in churches all over America that will wake up in hell and they believe they're on their way to heaven. I heard a statistic just the other day, 2 out of 3 men are taken by pornography. And that was a Christian statistic. And I'm thinking, my goodness gracious, there's 3 men in my house. There's 4 men in my house now. I'm like, Lord, are 3 of us off and 1 right? No, not my house. We're going to preach the word. We're going to come up against that demonic thing. But all it is really the description of the effective strategy of the satanic realm against men in the church today. And we're supposed to be turning people from the power of Satan to the power of God. And yet we go. I mean, we were just in a place. I could feel the thing. Yeah, you could, it was so thick I could cut it with a knife. And if I had started preaching on it and gotten tense on it, I'd have had an altar call full of people on it. But the Lord told me to preach on something else. I preached on what the Lord told me to preach on. And the meeting went to after midnight. I don't know if they've ever had a meeting there till after midnight or not, but they had one when I was there.
That's right.
Hallelujah. And it seemed like anybody was in a hurry to go anywhere. Praise God. Hallelujah. And somebody said, do you just try to have long meetings? No, it just happens. It just happens. I preach until the Lord tells me to stop preaching. Nothing to do with long-winded. Amen. I preach until the Lord tells me to stop preaching. And I praise God for the people who are anointed of the Lord. I was so blessed. A preacher, excuse me, or just said, just in fun, just said, oh, yeah, he's just long-winded. And then within 10, 15 minutes, he came just pleading, oh, please forgive me for saying that. I'm so sorry for saying that. I would not disrespect you anyway. I'm like, hey, listen, man, it's no problem. But you know what? That disposition is why he's anointed. That disposition is why he can so be used of God the Holy Ghost. Because he don't put anything off in a category of, oh, I shouldn't have done that. He recognizes when it's wrong, and he goes and he gets it right. People, can you hear me? Can you understand about the will of God and then preparing yourself and doing what's right and bring it down into your everyday life and stop envisioning yourself with a little lantern and a vessel of oil? And recognize we're talking about what's going on in your everyday life.
Right.
Hallelujah. Amen. Understand what's being said in Luke chapter 12. Before that, and it's really about our hearts and our lives so consecrated and so fixed on the things that Father's privileged us to enjoy in Him. I mean, how many of you have really been enjoying the revelation now that you have, that prayer is an opportunity for the Holy Spirit to be able to express Himself through you? Because it begins to create a whole nother prayer, see? With all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost, you see? They say, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Prayer is supposed to be an expression of the Holy Ghost. So many people haven't gotten that. They're still back, you know, doing the thing of, you know, the ballites cutting themselves or something in between that and whatever we're supposed to be doing. Believe me, I know, I understand these things. Why? I received them from the Lord Jesus Christ. by revelation to the Holy Ghost. It says provable in the Word. Because if somebody said they received something from the Lord Jesus Christ and it's revelation by the Holy Ghost and it can't be proven in the Word, then don't even pay any attention to it. It's wrong. Doesn't matter who it is, me, anyone. But if I say something by the Lord Jesus Christ and it's by revelation of the Holy Ghost, and then you can see it very clearly, it just all it does is open your eyes to what was already there, not have to see between the lines. It's right what's there. Hello. Don't have to read Greek and go, translate a particular way to get it. Are you with me? Praise God that that's not the way that the Word has been delivered unto us. Father's watched over His Word to perform it, and I'm telling you, He's got it in every translation. Amen. Hallelujah. Every major translation anyways. Because they got new translations, homosexual communities created, funded a new translation of the Bible. Other people translated new translation. Jehovah's Witness translated, you know, put a new translation of the Bible together. So I can't say every translation, but the dominant ones that belong to the church, the body of Christ. Hallelujah. Now listen to this. Afterwards came the other virgins saying, Lord, Lord, hear the word, Lord, Lord. Because then that's going to ring back of what Jesus had said previously at another time that's also recorded in Matthew chapter 7. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, it rings out. Lord, Lord. Lord, Lord, open to us. Let us in also. We want to participate. People, I've even found this to be true even in the moves of God, not just in the coming. But in, see, for me, parousia is not just the coming, because there is the event of the coming, but there are the continual comings of the Lord, His sovereign comings, to where the people who weren't prepared, they missed out. They're saying, I want in, but you have to watch this round. Because you weren't hungering, you weren't thirsting, you weren't in it in the time when it wasn't easy going, when it wasn't popular, when it wasn't all excitement. You weren't in it when there was a bit of pain and suffering and challenge and price to pay. You just set this one out. But this, however, is in the most dramatic way, exclusive. Here's what the Lord answers. Notice He's not a humanist. He doesn't say, well, you know what, let's just think. Come on, let's go to council together. Come on, let's talk about this. Pastor, I think you're being a little bit too strict here. Look, you're being a little rough. I mean, you're being a little old-fashioned, you know. You're being a little bit narrow on this. I mean, you need to consider a little bit more here. You need to bring a little more balance to your decision-making. Look at all that they've done. Here's what Jesus says. He answered them and said, I'll tell you with absolute certainty, I have no idea who you are. Cold. Cold, strict, absolute. I'll tell you with absolute certainty, I have no idea who you are. Jesus. I'm talking to you about people. I'm talking to you about who we are supposed to be in the kingdom of God. I'm talking to you about the witness of what we're supposed to be in the kingdom of God. I'm talking to you about various different states that would exclude us from being who we are supposed to be in the kingdom of God, because we're involved in this and we're involved in that, and we decide that this is how it also fits for us, and we neglect what God said. And the Lord says, if you neglect so great a salvation, you shall, you might, you run a risk. Huh? He uses a word, surely. Or absolutely, with absolute certainty, you shall perish. People just want to make God, you just accommodate me. Oh, I'm so glad, you know, that you're just cool. God's not cool. Because cool is that you're just like open to anything and you're always just tolerant of everyone. That's cool. Huh? You're just a free spirit. God's no free spirit. And somebody says you're a free spirit, that is not in any way a compliment for somebody who's supposed to be born of the Spirit and under the rulership and governorship of the Holy Ghost. I'm liberty. I have liberty, but my liberty is found only in Him. Amen. Freedom is only found in truth. There will never be freedom in a lie. That's why we see why our nation is in such a struggle. And our nation has been a lighthouse to the world of freedom, even in the narrow definition of that freedom. We've been a lighthouse of freedom. What happens when this light goes out? You think about where the state of the other nations of the world. Dear, we're in reality of this, is very few people know what's going on. Very few people are really preparing. And it isn't getting a 50-gallon barrel of lima beans and pinto beans and rice stored away. It's preparing to meet the master. It's preparing to hear the sound of a trumpet. To see the Lord come as an archangel. Hallelujah. To see the day in which the Lord comes. Everything is about to change, and it's about to radically change. And I'm going to tell you right now, dear people, come on now. Hallelujah. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to start reading the Bible. Start at Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. Start obeying God. Start reading Matthew 1, 1. Read through Revelation 22, 21. Just start obeying God. Don't just read it because now you're just reading. You're just reading and reading and reading so you can read the Bible. Start obeying God. Start becoming a part of God's program. Things that you read and you go, Lord, I just don't know how to do it, then fall upon your knees and cry out and say, Father, strengthen me to do it, because I just don't know how to do it. I don't understand to do it, but I want to do it. I want to do just exactly what you said. And get serious with God and start getting ready as those who are watching for his coming. I'm watching for his coming. And in watching for his coming, I'm prepared. I recognize that there are certain things that have got to happen. And I'm all the more earnest watching for his coming, because I'm going to tell you right now, dear people, I do not know if I will be alive tomorrow morning. I do not know if I'll be alive at the end of this day. And that's the biggest coming I'm concerned about. The moment in time when I may not be around when the Lord actually comes. I would love to go by way. I'd like to have what Enoch, something similar to Enoch had, never see death, but be changed at a moment, twinkling of an eye. There will be a people who will not see death, but they'll be changed in a moment, twinkling of an eye. And I don't know that I get to be a part of that. But I do know this. I get to be a part of standing before him on a day that he's determined. On a day that he's chosen. And I'm going to be prepared. Because I do not know what hour he will come. Whether in the first watch or the second watch or the third watch. I'm going to always be prepared. Because he don't come for me. Hallelujah. Death angel ain't coming for me. Christ Jesus coming for me. He said, I go away to prepare a place for you, and if I go away, I shall come and receive you unto myself. I take that as a personal promise and don't relegate that to an event in the future. As for me, as for my mama, my daddy, my granddaddy, everybody who died in Christ Jesus, who died in the Lord, hallelujah, hallelujah. The angels came and took them. Hallelujah. Thank you. Just stand with me. I just feel the mighty presence of the Lord. We preach for this purpose. We preach for the purpose that you would be consecrated to the Lord. We preach for the purpose that you would surrender everything to the Lord. Some people need to surrender to the Lord on the level that they've never been born again. They've never been made a new creation. They've not been changed. They're still old creature. They're still living in the realms of the demonic. The Lord invites you to come on into the kingdom of God. He says that the door is wide open. Jesus stands at the door of your heart and knocks. And of course, we know that that's actually Jesus talking about his church. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that there would be such a people as those described of Laodicea, who knew the will of the Father, but they didn't prepare themselves for it, and they had come to such a point that Jesus is on the outside of their life. Here they're still having church. They're still doing the thing. But he's standing at the door of their life, and he's knocking on the door of their hearts. And he's just saying, open up the door. Open unto me. Could you imagine that there's people that are unwilling to open unto him? Let him come in. That are those who supposedly know him
But the beautiful thing of it is, dear people, listen to me right now. Listen to me right now. It doesn't matter where you're at, whether you're still under the authority and the strongholds of Satan, whether you've backslidden, whether you've grown cold, whether you're passionate and on fire about the things of God, there is a place right now where Father in His love and His mercy is calling us to come in and receive everything that He has. He's passionate about it. He's desperate about it. And right now we give you an invitation to come into the kingdom of God. You do not know. This could be your last opportunity. You may not have another opportunity. But I want you to know, when you come, it is about a complete surrender of your life. Because Father, it isn't going to work. The reality of it is, you can come as many times as you want, but it's not going to work. This is my point. You can come and respond to the altar call as many times as you want, but it's not going to work until you've made up your mind you want to live for the kingdom of God, that you want to be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, that your former life has come to an end. You don't want it anymore. You want a new kind of life. Unfortunately, most people come to that in disaster, in crisis. My mother tells her testimony. She said, when I was 10 years old, I stood in a meeting and the power of God began to move. She said, I stood before the Lord as the worst sinner that ever lived. Because see, that's what God will do. God, the Holy Ghost, will come in His convicting power, and He will reveal sin for what it is. And He will cause a person, anybody who's willing to listen, to recognize that they are undone. A lot of people justify, oh, I know God. He's been around me all the time, taking care of me all my life. Nonsense. I'm not talking about that God. I'm talking about the one that transforms you and turns you into someone like Him, who walks in the light as He is in the light, who lives even as He lives. Hallelujah. Who's holy just like He's holy, who's pure just like He's pure, who loves righteousness just like He loves righteousness, hates iniquity just like He hates iniquity. 10 years old, can you imagine? Yeah, that's the movings of God and the Holy Ghost. And dear people, We're gonna have to do what's necessary in responding in obedience to God. So once again, that wind of the Spirit, that freedom of the Holy Ghost, can move through the churches and move through our lives with that kind of an impact. This is what Father's doing. He's looking for anyone who participate with Him. Because the Father's looking for pure vessels. Not silver vessels and golden vessels, pure vessels, yielded pure vessels. Jesus said, if you purge, or Paul said by the Lord Jesus, if you purge yourself from these things, then you are a vessel sanctified, purified, ready to be used of God, prepared unto every good work. It's time. It's time that the church rises in the brightness and the glory of the ministry of Jesus with authority over all the powers of darkness, to cast out unclean spirits, to deliver people from their sickness and their disease, to show all the world around us the ways of the living God. And Isaiah described it as the restorer of the paths to dwell in, the breach repairers. Hallelujah. Jesus is calling you right now. He loves you very dearly. Doesn't matter who you are. Doesn't matter where you're at right now. People from many different nations watching us on the web right now. What a blessing. Doesn't matter who you are, where you're at. He's calling you. He wants to bring you into this realm of oneness with Him and give you the authority, the power and the life to live out His glorious expectation, the majesty and the splendor of His life. Do not delay another day. Do not wait another moment. Just surrender to Him. He'll take you where you at and bring you all the way up to where He is. He'll take you from where you at right now, and by the transforming miracle power of the Holy Ghost, bring you all the way to where He is right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So everybody, would you just lift your hands towards heaven with me? Holy Ghost, we thank you for your purity. Holy Ghost, we thank you for your righteousness. Holy Ghost, we thank you for the work of salvation. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your precious blood that cleanses us from every sin. We thank you, Lord, that you forever live. You've made the meaning of your life, as it were, to pray for us, to intercede on our behalf. Lord, I pray right now, I ask you right now in your mercy and your grace that the floodlight of heaven will shine upon every soul, that every person in this place can come to recognize and appreciate and value more than anything else what you've done for them. When you died at Calvary's cross, when you went down into hell, you rose up from the dead on the third day. You ascended up into heaven. You seated at the right hand of the Father. You poured out the Holy Ghost. You at work right now with everything that you are and everything that you have to bring many sons into glory. And we pray, Father, that everybody that's listening under the sound of our voice will respond to such a privilege to come to you before it's forever too late. Father, we pray that there will not be one person in this place who delays or who neglects or who turns back and misses out. In Jesus' name. Now, if you want us to pray with you and for you for anything, we're here to pray with you, whether it's for salvation, addictions in your life, I don't care what it is, sickness, disease in your body, torment of the enemy, the torment of demon spirits, the powers of darkness working against you. Father has given us all authority against them to deliver you. Father's raised up deliverers. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, living God. Thank you, living God. Thank you, living God. Just be healed right now. Just be healed right now. Just be touched right now. Anybody you want prayer, you could just come stand up here. You want prayer for anything, you just come. If any need in your body, just come. Deliverers. Hallelujah. Deliverers. Socorro masanda de dei e shepekindo lo boshata. Merese tira lo mosanda da takana na sheo. Deliverers. O shikaranda da sheo tolo lo mosande e pakaya. Le yarona sana ne apura maya siya kaya bolo mosinga. Hallelujah. Ishi Ramonda da daya la masikte ingeshi perine shiata. Deliverers. Lurima manakandavista. Just begin to let the Lord just minister to you and convince you of what He's purposed you to be in Christ Jesus, the kind of ministry He wants you to have. Where that you can begin to go out and begin to deliver people. Isn't that amazing that you can be a deliverer? Obadiah, verse 21, said he should raise up deliverers in Zion. And that's not just talking about what God's going to do in the millennial reign. It's talking about what God's doing right now. He's looking for people who's willing to so embrace His ministry. You know, I cannot get away from this verse of scripture. It's what I was going to open up with here. And so I'm going to read it to you. It's in Mark chapter 6. It's verse 11 and 12. Hand me the bigger Bible, please. I want a big word, big Bible. I don't care how you feel about yourself. It's irrelevant. I want you to start feeling about Jesus, what you're supposed to be feeling about Him. Too many people exalt their own selves. Stop feeling about yourself. God's not interested in how you feel about you. Father's interested in how you feel about Jesus. And if you begin to start feeling about Jesus the way the Holy Ghost wants to teach you to feel about him, then you get to be a deliverer. Mark chapter 6, verse 11 and 12. Jesus said, "And whosoever shall not receive you, now let's go to verse 12. And they went out and preached that men should repent. And they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick. And he healed them." He made them deliverers. He made them deliverers. Hallelujah. To go out and set the captives free. The word of God will begin to produce faith in you. Listen to me. The word of God will begin to produce faith in you, but the word of God has got to become bigger to you than what you feel and what you think. I mean, not only what you feel physically, but what you feel emotionally. I love what Smith Wigglesworth said, and he was named to be the apostle of faith in the generation that he lived in. He said, I don't ask myself how I feel. I tell myself how I feel. If you grab a hold of the word and say it's going to be this way, it isn't going to be any other way. I'm going to have it God's way, not my way, his way. That begins, and all of a sudden you exalting God's word about everything. He said it so. Let not the inhabitants of the Lord say I'm sick. That's some pretty radical stuff. Command ye me, says the Lord. That's some radical faith. You know, but here, you used to hear people preach on things, messages like that. Preachers try to preach messages like that. There wouldn't be anybody in the house, hardly. Well, it will be again. It will be again. You know why? Because here's what's going to happen. God in his love and mercy is going to make people hungry for the word, and they're going to get tired of preacher preaching. Just another thing. You're going to get hungry for the word. You're going to get hungry for the revelation of the word. It's true. Change is going to take place. Get ready. Get ready. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is right here, right now, for you to do whatever you ask him to do, to meet whatever need you have. Just turn your heart towards him. Just turn your heart towards him. Right now in the name of Jesus, every yoke is broken. Every sickness, every disease is removed. Hallelujah.